Hello everyone. In this video, we will be talking about how to get started on the FASRC compute cluster. Our learning objectives here are for you to be able to describe the structure of a compute cluster, to be able to log in to the FASRC cluster, and to demonstrate how to start an interactive session with the SLURM job scheduler. First, let's talk about the architecture of a cluster. In this schematic, you will notice several things have been labeled in the little gray boxes. As a user, you will log in to a computer called the login node. This login node or computer is essentially your gateway into accessing the resources on the compute cluster. You can request resources on any of the compute nodes or computers using something called a SLURM job scheduler. We will talk about SLURM momentarily. All of the data on a compute cluster is always stored on shared disks. This ensures that all the nodes or computers on the cluster have access to the data. Before we get too far into this video, here are a few basic terms associated with the cluster. This is by no means a comprehensive list of terms, but just the more common ones you will encounter. The most basic thing you need to know is that a cluster is a group of computers that are connected to each other. These computers are designed differently from personal computers in that they are much more powerful. Each of the computers in a cluster is called a node, and nodes in the cluster are connected to each other by a high-speed interconnect known as InfiniBand, sometimes referred to as IB. Essentially, information can pass between the components of a cluster very fast. A node is made up of a CPU, memory or RAM, and a local hard drive. The abbreviation CPU, as you may already know, stands for Central Processing Unit. Each CPU usually contains multiple cores that perform the computation. For example, a CPU with 4 cores can run 4 distinct processes at once. Nodes on the cluster have CPUs with a lot of cores and a lot more CPUs per machine compared to a personal computer. We will be discussing how to take advantage of these resources via parallelization in a different video. In addition to a CPU, some of the nodes on the cluster also have GPUs, or graphical processing units, which are designed for accelerated applications. You can find out more about GPUs on the documentation page. As you can imagine, the first thing you'll need to do to work on a cluster is to log in. And to log in, you will need to get an account. We have more information about how to get an account in our quick start guide. We encourage you to look it up. Once you have an account, you can actually log into the cluster and start working. To log in, you will use the basic shell command called SSH, which stands for Secure Shell. This is a protocol for data transfer that is encrypted and secure. All you have to do is, in a bash command line interface, type in SSH, your username, and the address of the compute cluster you want to connect to. In this case, it is login.rc.fas.harvard.edu. So when I start talking about using the command line interface, what exactly is this? Where can you find it? The Mac operating system comes with a basic utility called Terminal, which will allow you to use the SSH command to connect to the cluster. Similarly, Linux has Xterm or Terminal, which will also let you do this. You can search for one of these applications on your computer, depending on your operating system. Once you open it, you'll be able to type in the SSH command. Things are a little different for Windows. You'll have to download either an SSH client or a Bash emulator. Some examples of SSH clients and Bash emulators are listed in the slide. Depending on which one you choose to use, the logging in method will be slightly different. If you've decided to use a Bash emulator, you will just be typing in the SSH command like I mentioned earlier. If you choose to go with an SSH client, please look at our documentation for instructions on how to log in. Once you type in the SSH command and press Enter, first you'll be asked for your password. Note that the cursor is not going to move as you type your password in, but your information will be going through. After the password, press Enter. Next, the system will ask you for a verification code. This is part of two-factor authentication that has been put in place for the cluster. It is similar to what you might do for the Harvard key, except you have to enter 6 numbers associated with your account. To get this verification code, you will have to set up the two-factor authentication for your account. The tool you will be using is called OpenAuth or Open Authentication Tool. You can find out more information about this on the OpenAuth page within the Quick Start Guide. You will need this to log in, so please do look it up ahead of time since it requires a few steps for setup. Once you enter both the password and verification code, you will be logged in. And you know you're logged into the login node because your command prompt will have the word login in it. Here's a short demo of what the logging in process will look like on the terminal. Please note that if you're using PuTTY or similar on a Windows machine, the process is a little different, and you can find more information about it on the documentation page. In this demo, I have the OpenAuth Java desktop app set up to give me the verification code. Note that this code will update frequently in the app, and to log in, you will have to use the one that is current. Once you have both a terminal open and a verification code handy, you can run the SSH command, followed by entering your password and then your verification code. Once you log in, note that the command prompt on the cluster has the word login in it. This login computer is not designed for you to do any analysis, so you shouldn't be doing anything that is compute or memory intensive on this node. We recommend that as soon as you log in, you start something called an interactive job or an interactive session where you're actually doing your work on a compute node. The reason it's called an interactive session is because you're working on the compute node interactively by typing in commands that the compute node is now running for you. To start this interactive session, you will be using commands associated with the SLURM job scheduler. The SLURM job scheduler is a resource management tool that users interact with to request access to resources. SLURM also has a built-in way to ensure that no single user or lab group hogs all the resources. It does this by assigning fair share scores. We'll be talking a lot more about SLURM, including additional ways to interact with the compute nodes as well as fair share in a separate video. To start an interactive job or interactive session, you have to use the SLURM command srun. Srun, along with the argument --pty, signal to SLURM that you want to start working on a compute node interactively. In addition, you have to specify a few more arguments to make sure that SLURM is allocating the resources you need, resources like memory, time, and more. The first argument specified here is -p. The P here stands for partition. A partition is essentially a group of nodes that have been set aside to do a specific type of computing. In this case, the test partition is requested. This is a good partition to request for an interactive session, as there is little or no wait to get a compute node assigned to you. In addition, you will have to specify the amount of memory needed. In this case, we are requesting 100 megabytes. Finally, you have to let SLURM know how long you want this interactive session for. And here we are asking for 1 hour. And last but not least, you'll have to let SLURM know that you want to use the bash shell. This shell is pretty standard, and the way you specify it is by saying /bin/bash. Once you run the srun command, you will be assigned a compute node, and the name of this node will be in your updated command prompt. You are now all set to get going with your work. Note that this interactive session will be active as long as your local computer is connected to the internet or for the duration you requested in the srun command. To exit the interactive job, you can use the exit command. This will bring you back to the login node. The exit command will also close your connection to the cluster. So just a little bit more about partitions available on the cluster. Each column in this table represents a different partition that is available on the cluster. The first row tells you how long you can run a specific process on that partition. The second, third, and fourth rows tell you what the total number of nodes, cores per node, and the memory per node that you can request. If you want more information, you can use the sinfo or scontrol commands to obtain more information about specific partitions. Sinfo and scontrol are both SLURM commands. We will be talking a lot more about partitions in a different video as well. Thanks so much for your attention. I hope this video was useful for you to start using the FASRC cluster. Listed on this slide is some more information about resources and how to request help. All the best.